About 20 million Americans are on warfarin, and another 2 million start taking the drug each year. Warfarin belongs to a class of drugs called anticoagulants, which simply means they work against the formation of blood clots in your body. Most of the people I talk to who are on warfarin seem to know a lot about their medication, but to share all that information with everyone, I decided to make this video to fill in the gaps for anyone else who is on warfarin and still has questions. So stay tuned until the end. Although it's not a complete breakdown about everything on warfarin, as that would take hours, I tried to hit 6 major points, so if you find this video useful, please give it a like. Usually warfarin is prescribed to those after a major surgery, such as a hip or knee replacement, or for those with artificial heart valves, or for those with conditions such as chronic atrial fibrillation or deep vein blood clots, because these conditions essentially all put you at a risk for developing harmful blood clots. That's why the first thing we'll look at is the issue of clotting. Blood clots are necessary in order to stop you from bleeding out entirely each time you have a gash or an open wound. And these are called beneficial blood clots because they prevent or stop excessive blood loss, but harmful blood clots can cause a heart attack, stroke, deep vein thrombosis, and pulmonary embolisms, which can be life-threatening because blood flow past the clot inside the artery or vein is heavily decreased and blood isn't getting to where it needs to go, which essentially is the biggest fear. These are all conditions which we are trying to prevent by taking warfarin. So the overall goal is to help keep your blood flowing smoothly, decreasing the clotting tendency just enough that it does not prevent clotting completely. So it's a fine balance between blood not clotting and blood clotting. And oftentimes you hear the word blood thinner, but that doesn't refer to warfarin because essentially warfarin doesn't thin the blood at all. It instead causes the blood to take a longer time to form a clot by blocking the formation of what's called vitamin K dependent clotting factors. And since warfarin works against vitamin K in the liver, blocking these clotting factors and essentially vitamin K, your body can stop harmful clots from forming and growing larger. Let's move on to the second thing, which is lab tests. The major one being INR, which stands for International Normalized Ratio, and it determines how fast your blood clots. You'll usually get this checked at least once a month and sometimes as often as twice weekly. A high value means it takes longer for your blood to clot, while a low value means it clots faster. Someone who is not on anticoagulants will have an INR of 1, but if you are on warfarin, your doctor will want to maintain your INR at the therapeutic range, because if your INR gets too high, you'll be at a risk of bleeding, and if it's too low, you're at a risk for clotting. Most patients on warfarin have an INR goal of 2 to 3, but keep in mind this may differ. If a patient has an INR of 2 to 3, this just basically means it takes 2 or 3 times longer for that person's blood to clot than someone who is not taking any anticoagulants. Hopefully that makes sense. At the same time, it's very important that you attend all your regular appointments at your anticoagulation clinic so they can check your INR and make sure your dose is correct at all times. The third thing is watch for things that affect your INR and warfarin itself. This includes certain medications, foods, drinking too much alcohol, herbal medications, and even supplements, which is why it's so important to check with your doctor before trying any new products. I'll give you an example. Ibuprofen is a normal over-the-counter medication, but it enhances the anticoagulant effects of warfarin and increases the likelihood of harmful bleeding. For foods, eating an increased amount of foods rich in vitamin K can lower your INR, making warfarin less effective and potentially increasing the risk of blood clots. These foods are green and leafy vegetables such as broccoli, asparagus, Brussels sprouts, turnips, greens, lettuce, kale, spinach, and even mayonnaise. It's not necessary to avoid these foods, however, it is important to try to keep this amount of vitamin K consistent. So keep away from drastic changes in vitamin K rich foods. I'll leave all the food interactions warfarin has in the description below, so definitely check that out. For alcohol, alcohol should be limited to no more than 1 to 2 servings of alcohol occasionally, and might be even best to avoid it altogether. So definitely be aware of these things. For herbals and supplements, you have an increased bleeding risk if, let's say, you take garlic or ginkgo biloba with warfarin, or you have an increased clotting risk if you take, let's say, CoQ10, St. John's wort, or ginseng with warfarin. So definitely be aware of these things. The fourth thing, if you require long-term warfarin therapy, you should wear a medical alert bracelet, necklace, or some type of alert tag at all times, because if an accident occurs and you're too ill to communicate, a medical alert tag will help responders provide the appropriate care you need. The alert should include a list of major medical conditions and the reason warfarin is needed, as well as the name and phone number of an emergency contact. With that said, if you're seeing any new doctor or dentist for care, let them know you are using this medicine. The fifth thing is to watch for signs and symptoms of bleeding and easily bruising, especially if the bleeding does not stop. This includes unexplainable and growing bruises, nosebleeds, bleeding gums, pink or brown urine, red or black tarry stools, coughing up blood, vomiting blood, or coffee ground-like vomiting symptoms. These are all signs you should let your doctor know of. Some things you could do to prevent these are using a soft bristle toothbrush, floss with wax floss versus unwax floss, shave with an electric razor versus a blade, be careful when dealing with sharp objects, and avoid contact sports as best as possible. And lastly, the final thing I'll leave you with is never double up on a dose because you missed one. If you miss a dose, take it as soon as possible on the same day. However, if it's almost time for your next dose the next day, skip the missed dose and go back to your regular dosing schedule. I can't stress this enough because we don't want to double dose on warfarin. Using a pill box or dosing calendar can help you keep better track, so check out the links for them in the description below. I know this isn't a full list of cautions and procedures, but hopefully is enough to help answer some of your major questions and give you better insight on its interactions, monitoring, as well as what to watch for. I hope this video was useful to you. Please give it a like as this helps me out a ton, and subscribe to the channel for more helpful videos. And as always, see you on the next one.